And the other thing I really thought we should find out about is who our members were. And so I think we also commissioned the first survey of the Society for Neuroscience. You know, who were these people? Where were they located?
Now that we as a society offer year-round value for becoming members, we hope to use that and advertise that fact as they advance in their career from graduate student to postdoc to faculty, or even working in a non-academic environment, still in the field of neuroscience. I think we still want to make sure that we provide value. Being part of the society is worthwhile.
I remember being at a council meeting 10 or 12 years ago, and Marty mentioned that 40% of our membership was students and postdocs, and then my jaw hit the floor because oh my God, how are we going to find all these people jobs? And so we started about that time putting a lot more effort into professional development, mentoring, and making sure that our young people had good opportunities.
And then this year, liaison for the Trainee Advisory Committee actually put together a proposal to SfN to build a leadership development program that would roll out over the course of 3 years and grow. And that leadership development program would be specific for neuroscientists to come to SfN and get actual training on leadership skills that would cross over between academic and non-academic careers. And then the other piece that we're working on with SfN is, how do we make that a year long of a much greater program that feeds back into communities and makes that a meaningful opportunity for the neuroscientists that are participating?
The Neuroscience Training Committee is very intentional about developing programming for neuroscientists across the lifespan. So you have programs that might be introductory on new techniques, but really we are using the web platform of Neuro Online to really focus on digital learning opportunities. So individuals who, you know, may not use a particular technique or focus in a different, in a specific research area, we can create content for them that they can actually absorb from their office or, you know, their personal computer, where they can watch webinars on particular topics. And this is programming that is delivered online, so international members can access it, students can access it. There are people that now are arranging watch parties, so you can watch the webinars or the virtual conference as a group.
So one of the initiatives that we undertook was, how can we kind of have concentric circles of support? And so yes, we only had enough money to bring a certain number of individuals to the meeting every year, but we had enough to double or triple the number of individuals who could actually get mentoring support or get some other kind of professional development support by way of like a virtual conference. So I'm really proud of the work that they've continued along those lines.
So in terms of thinking about membership and diversity of Society for Neuroscience, at least my thinking about this back then was much broader. Not just diversity in terms of race, but it was also diversity in terms of the international society. How do we get them involved? How do we get people who are traditionally sidelined, people with hearing impairments, so visual impairments and so forth? So we took a much broader scope to this and helped to bring opportunities such as simple things like having a room where mothers can go with their kids. So it was a very broad scope bringing diversity to neuroscience.
I've been fiercely fighting for ways to remove barriers that exist for people to have the same opportunities that I've had. And again, just as with the international perspective, that's not only because it makes us feel good, it's not only the right thing to do, it also makes the scientific enterprise better, because it means we're better capturing all of the outstanding expertise that exists across humanity.
We need to work very hard to attract minorities into neuroscience, because neuroscience has gotten so broad in its ken. It deals with social issues, it deals with poverty, it deals with the effects of poverty and diet and drug exposure, all these things that impact people who are poor and underserved minorities. I see them as bringing a special perspective and energy.
Part of the challenge is, how does one advance change and not have it being viewed as a takeaway from someone else?
And I know in working in, the labs that I was exposed to in graduate school, I really fear that we're losing too many women and we're not closing the leaky pipeline. I think this is a really important mission for all of us. We need to have representation from women as well as men. I think we've got to be creative in getting more women to stay in the field. And actually, we've got to be more creative in getting men and women both to stay in neuroscience. It's hard. It's really rewarding.
When I was thinking about my presidential lectures, I said, after all these years of being a woman in science, you get tired of seeing lists of men and lists of men and lists of men and lists of men. I could find 30 outstanding female speakers, and they've been underrepresented, so why not? And I knew that I'd get some amount of flack about it. I chose four really outstanding scientists. It was a statement, clearly. Everybody understood it was a statement, and the young women understood it as a statement, and they really appreciated it.
And I've gotten other people in leadership to make the same changes to what I call affirmative attention. That I think every time we do something, every time we put together a dinner list, every time we put together a list of speakers on a panel, or a symposium, we need to pay attention to diversity, because if we don't pay attention, we're gonna lapse into just having our closest friends.
When we stop talking about diversity, we'll actually consider ourselves successful.